Hello everyone, welcome to another exciting episode of Day Spring Discussions. I'm your host, Sean McGahey. This is a show where we talk about movies, TV, sci-fi, fantasy, comic books. If you geek out about it, we're going to talk about it. You can listen to Day Spring Discussions on iTunes, YouTube, Podomatic, and Patreon, and contact Day Spring Discussions on the Facebook group, Twitter account, and dayspringdiscussions@gmail.com. Well, happy Tuesday, everyone. Hope you guys are enjoying your week. I gotta be honest, I just got back from lunch with my wife. Double Dave's, pizzeria buffet, my belly is full, I'm a little tired, but I have to come and do this show, otherwise I'm not gonna get a chance to do it. So, if I seem a little less energetic, because my belly is full of pizza right now, and it's bringing me down a bit, but nevertheless, we've got a lot of good stuff to talk about today. A lot of good stuff. Looking forward, though, to Friday. The Dark Crystal Age of Resistance comes out on Netflix. And then you also got the Amazon series Carnival Row with Orlando Bloom that comes out as well. That's going to come out on Friday. I'm going to watch that, talk about that next week. And then next week, we got season 2 of Titans, which is set to come out on DC Universe. So a lot of good stuff to look forward to, a lot of good stuff to talk about. I'm thinking maybe I might do a show on Friday instead of Thursday. I usually do, like I said, a Thursday show and a Tuesday show when I try, but I have Friday off. Plus, my buddy Jaime said he'd come over and talk Young Justice with me. This morning, DC Universe came out with the season finale of Young Justice Outsiders, the season 3 of the show. I watched it this morning. My buddy Jaime watches it. I want to talk a little bit more in depth. He's allegedly coming on Friday, and we're going to go over the whole season, talk about what we thought about it. So we're saving that for Friday. If he doesn't come over, I'm still going to talk a little bit about it and then a few other things. So I think my next episode is going to be on Friday, so stay tuned for that. But as for this episode, there's a lot to talk about, guys. As you know, D23, the big Disney convention they have every other year, was this past weekend. And we're talking Disney. In regards to this show, we're talking Star Wars and Marvel. They brought in quite a few things. You got the Disney Plus panel, which talked about TV stuff. And then you also had on the next day the film panel, where they talked more about stuff. And there's plenty to talk about. So I want to just go over a little bit here. Probably going to talk more Star Wars than Marvel, because there's a lot more Star Wars stuff that I'm more excited for than Marvel. Not that, you know, the people at Marvel didn't give us some stuff, but in any event, I'm more excited for what Star Wars has an offer. But okay, so Friday, first day, they're talking Disney Plus in regards to Disney's television platform or whatever. And Disney Plus is the big thing. It's coming out in November, and they're putting a lot of their chips into that basket. Makes sense, of course, with how big streaming is right now. It makes sense that they really want to try to dominate the market right out of the gate, and I think they're going to do a good job of it, especially given the fact they've got a lot of good Disney programming, Marvel programming, Star Wars programming, a lot of original content, a lot of good stuff that's going to be out from the gate in November. I'm definitely looking forward to it. I literally can't wait to sign up for this thing. But in regards to Marvel, you had, I believe it was Kevin Feige came out during the Disney Plus panel on Wednesday and was talking more about, you know, what they had coming up in Disney Plus. Of course, we know they've, you know, announced Falcon and Winter Soldier. You've got your What If, you've got your Hawkeye, your WandaVision. There's something I'm forgetting, and I don't remember what it is. Anyway, other stuff coming out in regards to just the Disney Plus service. And they went a little more detail about a few things. So first off, let's just stick with that, WandaVision. So this one, they gave a few more details about. First off, it's going to be a little bit, you know, epic Marvel, they said, but also a little more sitcom-y, where they were showing clips of like Dick Van Dyke and stuff like that, which seemed a little off. They did announce a couple of new cast members. Now, Kat Dennings, who played Darcy in the Thor films, is going to be in it. You've also got Randall Park, who played the FBI agent in Ant-Man and the Wasp. He's going to be in it. And then Catherine Hahn is going to be playing, allegedly, the kooky neighbor, as they call her. I love Catherine Hahn. I think she's great, especially in Parks and Rec when she plays Paul Rudd's campaign manager. Great actress. I love her in whatever she is. So looking forward to that. So they've joined the cast. Got a little more information about what it's going to be like. And as we know, WandaVision is going to lead directly into the Doctor Strange sequel. What is it? Doctor Strange and Tales from the Multiverse or something like that. Anyway, that's going to lead from WandaVision. And, you know, they put out a little picture, of course, of Wanda and Vision in like this Susie Homemaker 1950s home. People are speculating that Wanda is going to increase her power ability, because in the comics she's very powerful. House of M, she's able to reshape reality. So what if she reshapes reality and what to life she wants, where her and Vision are living happily ever after and Vision never died? That could definitely lead into some multiverse problems, which of course would bring in Doctor Strange. But yeah, it sounds a little interesting. You know, I think with these shows, with the superhero genre, comic book genre, whatever you want to say, you got to try to branch out, you know. And much like how Deadpool really stuck out because it was so different from a lot of the other superhero comic book properties at that time, I think you have to, you know, again, switch it up, do the subgenres, do something a little more out there if you want the genre to stay fresh and different. So something like this where it could be a little more kooky, I understand that. You know, it makes sense. So I'm interested, of course. I was already going to watch it, so you don't really have to sell me on anything. I'm going to check it out no matter what. But given this different aspect of it, it does seem a little interesting, so to speak. But okay, so next up they talked about Falcon and Winter Soldier, and they're talking about how Emily Van Camp is going to reprise her role as Sharon Carter, so she's going to be in there. As we know, of course, we get Zemo back in this one, and then also they added another cast member. Wyatt Russell will play, allegedly, U.S. Agent. Now, in the comics, the character John Walker is one of the few men who has taken over the Captain America roles in the comics. When Steve Rogers resigned as Captain America, Walker was the government's first choice to replace him. However, Rogers ultimately reclaimed his role after Walker proved to be too unstable to be Captain America. Instead, Walker took on a new persona, U.S. Agent. So, this to me, I think, kind of fits right into what we've been talking about, or what we've been hearing about the series, where it's a world without Captain America, and Steve has passed the shield to Falcon, or to, what's Falcon's real name? To, why am I skipping? The Anthony Mackie, he plays, okay, I'm going to skip it. I'm going to skip it for now. Anyway, Falcon is going to be the new Cap, or allegedly, but there are people who might have problems with it. Sam Wilson, I got it. I thought of it. I just now thought of it. Ha! Anyway, passes on to Sam. Sam might not want to do it, or people might not want him to do it, and maybe they have this John Walker character who is the government's choice instead of Sam. I could definitely see there being a pushback, a tug of war, so to speak, over the Captain America mantle. Again, adding this character as this actor definitely, I think, opens up more story possibilities, more drama to it all, and I think could be very interesting if played right. Now, when it comes to the films, of course, they were talking about, you know, Eternals coming out. They showed footage of Black Widow, and, you know, we also got an announcement that Kit Harington, who has been rumored to be some involvement with Marvel coming up in the near future, was announced. He's going to play the Black Knight, actually, in the Eternals film. Now, this character, he's been an Avenger, and he's, you know, hung around the Eternals quite a bit, so it makes sense. It's very interesting, of course, that he's going to team back up with his old Game of Thrones co-star Richard Madden for the Eternals. But in any event, you know, if you look at what Kit Harington does and the Black Knight, they seem to match up pretty well. I'm not a huge, you know, fan of the character. I'm not very familiar with him because of that, but what I know about him, I think Kit Harington has enough acting chops to do it justice, and it's Marvel. You know, they do great on their casting, so if Kevin Feige and the rest of the crew over there believe he can do this character, then I have to believe them as well. They announced three new series coming to Disney+. They got Moon Knight, She-Hulk, and Ms. Marvel. Totally blew people away. Moon Knight is one of those characters that has been talked about for a while by hardcore geeks wanting to see some rendition of him, possibly a film. She-Hulk is a character, probably the one I'm most familiar with out of the three, so I'm excited to see her. And then Ms. Marvel, a character who has popped up in the last decade as a very popular character in the comic books. She's also part of the Inhumans a little bit, but also, you know, she covers a little bit of the minority demographic, which, you know, I think makes her a little more popular, and it's great. I think that's great to get characters like that in the MCU. Anyway, like I said, the character I'm most familiar with is She-Hulk. There have been, you know, several recent renditions of her where she's gone back between human and Hulk, though most renditions she's just, you know, She-Hulk. She, you know, has strength and she's green, but she has total cognitive abilities of what she's doing. But also she's a lawyer, so you could definitely play with kind of procedural, I think, with that. It could be interesting. Again, messing with the genre a little bit, giving it a little more interesting subgenre, keeping it fresh, you know. Got to keep things feeling new to keep them fresh and relevant. As far as Moon Knight, I don't know a lot about the character either. I know he's a vigilante who's on the streets, you know, beating crap out of guys. Pretty violent character, which is why I'm surprised he landed more on Disney Plus rather than Hulu. But in any event, you know, he's a guy, he teams up with the New York characters like Daredevil and Luke Cage and all them quite a bit. And again, he's a bit violent, so I'm interested to see exactly just how far they're willing to take this character on a Disney Plus streaming service. But it's cool, you know, like I said, I'm looking forward to everything they have going on. Some of these characters I'm not too familiar with, but it's Marvel, you know, so you just gotta have faith in them, and it's Kevin Feige and crew, and they have yet to let me down yet, so let's just see what they got in store. Oh, yeah, and one last thing, they did announce Black Panther 2 coming May 2nd, 2022, brought Ryan Coogler out. Okay, we all knew Black Panther 2 was coming. They set a date, which was great, but, I mean, wasn't anything too excited about in my eyes because we knew it was going to come eventually. But, you know, that's coming too, so we can look forward to that. Okay, so let's jump over to the galaxy far, far away. I'm going to spend the rest of the time talking Star Wars. Yes, they talked Star Wars a little bit on the Disney Plus panel on Friday, and then they talked a little more Star Wars on Saturday. So let's start with Friday, Disney Plus. We got our first look at The Mandalorian. Well, not our first look, because they showed a behind-the-scenes thing at Star Wars Celebration, but our first trailer for The Mandalorian came out at D23, and of course, this series is going to be launching the very first day of Disney Plus. November 12th, I believe, is when the streaming service comes out, and this series, set about 5 years after Return of the Jedi, we see Pedro Pascal as the Mandalorian, and we really don't know much about him besides that he's a bounty hunter. Looks like he's kicking a little butt. I definitely enjoyed at the end there where you saw a bunch of people frozen in carbonite, and I guess that's just kind of the cool thing to do when you're a bounty hunter, is transport people in carbonite. Maybe it keeps them safer, keeps them a little less out of your hair as you transport them, but that was pretty cool. But he was kicking ass, taking names. You saw stormtrooper helmets on spikes. Woo, man. You know, with this, I'm a guy in Star Wars. I like the Jedi, the Sith, the Force, the myth, you know, the lore over the war, as they call it. So, with Mandalorian, I'm excited we're getting a Star Wars series. But I don't see any Jedi, I don't see any of the Force users there. So I'm not as excited to say some other things that are upcoming. But I am excited that it's a Star Wars series. I'm excited to see how they deal with this time frame of, you know, post-Empire, as the Rebel Alliance is starting to become the Republic again, and that transition era, and what the state of the galaxy is just a few years after the destruction of the second Death Star and the fall of the Empire. That, to me, that's the most interesting thing about this series. You saw a lot of cool imagery, though. A lot of stuff to get a lot of people excited. A lot of people are thinking this is the most interesting thing in Star Wars coming up. To me, it's not, but the fact that Jon Favreau, who's a great filmmaker, is showrunning this gives me a little more hope. But also Dave Filoni helping out, directing the very first episode of this series. Filoni, probably the greatest mind working on Star Wars right now, in my eyes and probably a lot of people's eyes. The fact that he is helping do this as well as directing that first episode gives me a lot of hope for this series as well. And again, I'm looking forward to see where it's going. Also on the TV front, we got an announcement that Clone Wars is coming back February of next year. So we got, you know, not an official date, but a month in which it's going to come out. I myself, huge fan of the Clone Wars. I really enjoy it. Some of the best Star Wars in my eyes. So I'm excited for Dave Filoni and his crew to come back and finish this chapter of the Star Wars saga. What we saw, the trailer we saw at Star Wars Celebration was awesome. Completely awesome. Made me so look forward to all of it wrapping up the Clone Wars, letting Dave Filoni finish off what he wanted to do, how he wanted to do it. And looks like, of course, we're going to get the big showdown between Ahsoka and Darth Maul. Going into that, it just makes me super excited. So I'm excited more than even Mandalorian to see the end of Clone Wars. And then to end the panel, Kathleen Kennedy brought out none other than Ewan McGregor. And Ewan McGregor, you know, for the last couple years, he's been asked on every interview, well, are you going to be Obi-Wan again? Or what's going on with Star Wars? And, you know, he said, yeah, I'd like to be Obi-Wan again, but nobody's asked me. You know, basically playing coy. And finally, he got to say on stage at D23 in front of all the fans that he is indeed going to be Obi-Wan Kenobi once again in a live-action Disney Plus series. Scripts have already been written. They're going to shoot this thing starting next year, which means next year in August at Star Wars Celebration, you can bet we're going to be getting probably a trailer and some footage, and that makes me most excited. Obi-Wan Kenobi, my second favorite character in the Star Wars universe next to Luke, because of what, you know, McGregor has done with the character in the prequels and the way his character has expanded throughout Clone Wars as well. I love him. I love his snarky attitude. I'm super looking forward to this. Now, it's been a long journey, though, for this, because we heard rumors as far back as several years ago that, you know, they were thinking about doing an Obi-Wan movie. And, you know, after the success of Rogue One, it looked like we were good. After the not-so-success of Solo, I think Lucasfilm allegedly put everything on halt and kind of redesigned what they were going to do. And last week, rumors came out that an Obi-Wan series was more than likely coming. And nothing was confirmed. I mean, you know, it was all rumors, but it was coming from the major trades. And I wish that wouldn't have come out, because it would have made McGregor coming on a stage that much more excited. I mean, I was happy and giddy as a schoolgirl to see him come on stage, but if I had not heard about it, or, you know, even an inkling that it, you know, it might happen, I probably would have wet my pants. I probably would have, but I was expecting it a little bit, so I was still super happy about it, but I would have been more happy if I had not heard the rumors the week before. And so now people are talking about what it's going to be about. I don't think we really know if it's going to be a series or even a mini-series. I could go either way. I think a mini-series of maybe like 8 episodes or 10 episodes would be a nice way to go. Really just a really long movie. I think that'd be really cool. Storyline-wise, you know, I mean, there's plenty for him to do on Tatooine. If you look at what they've done with the character in the Star Wars comics and the little stories they've done with him just in that, there are plenty of dangers to navigate just on Tatooine alone, so you could definitely pull something off there. You know, it was 20 years. He was on Tatooine, allegedly looking after Luke. Who's to say he was there the whole time? He could easily have stepped off one or two times to deal with a few things. You know, some people are thinking maybe he would have stepped off after learning that Anakin was alive and indeed Darth Vader. He would have stepped off to maybe see what was going on with that. I think there are endless possibilities. However, some people who are talking about, oh, they should bring back Darth Maul after Solo. Dude, okay, if anyone who says that, okay, you're not watching Clone Wars or Rebels, and therefore, in my opinion, have no weight to your opinion as to what's going on in the Star Wars universe. Now, I get it. Some people just watch the movies. That's great, and that's fine. You know, enjoy it. I call those people Padawans, okay? If you watch the movies and the TV shows, I call you Knights. And if you read the books and the comics as well, I call you Masters. So if you're a Padawan and you enjoy the movies, more power to you. That's great. But the moment someone comes up to me and says, oh, they should bring back Darth Maul for Obi-Wan to fight, get out of my face. I'm sorry. Get out of my face. I just laugh at them. You know, even I was watching Collider Jedi Council and their guest on there. There was a question about what character they'd like to see maybe in Mandalorian. The guest, I forget who it was, brought up Ventress. And Christian Harloff and Ken Napsok just looked at each other. And then they looked at him and be like, dude, read Dark Disciple. You know, read Dark Disciple and you'll figure out what happened to Ventress. So, Obi-Wan, super excited about it. Just the quality of what they can do with that. And Kathleen Kennedy said that these series are going to be of film quality. I mean, if you look at the Mandalorian trailer and how beautiful everything looks, I totally agree. It totally looks great. Now, I know they did bring out the Cassian crew as well. I don't think we really learned too much from them, except for like, hey, here's the cast of Cassian Andor series. I mean, that was pretty much all I heard about, is that they came out, said hi, and they left. I mean, big whoop. But anyway, guys, Star Wars, Disney Plus, a lot of stuff coming. So I'm thinking probably what they'll do in regards to Star Wars. You'll have Mandalorian. When Mandalorian ends, then you're going to have Clone Wars. When Clone Wars ends, I'm thinking Cassian. And then when Cassian ends, probably going to go for Obi-Wan. Beyond that, I'm sure they got other stuff up their sleeve. And again, talking about Obi-Wan and story-wise, what you can do with that, let's look no further than what has happened to that character up until that point, past Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. You know, just in the prequel trilogy, I remember when Revenge of the Sith came out on DVD, I skipped all my college classes that day, actually, and I watched all six Star Wars movies from Episode 1 to Episode 6. And, you know, it gives you a new perspective on things when you watch them in a row all at once like that. And by the end of Episode 3, I felt so sorry for Obi-Wan Kenobi. This is a guy who, you know, had lost his best friend back in Qui-Gon. And by Episode 3, you know, his house had burned down, the Jedi Temple. All his friends, the Jedis, were dead. His very best friend, Anakin, was basically responsible for it all. And then, of course, you go in and you add the layers of the Clone Wars with, you know, him being a Jedi and being trained a certain way his whole life. Then he had to go and be a general, something he totally didn't expect. None of the Jedis did. And then, you know, he loses Satine, and it's just all a lot for that character by the end of Revenge of the Sith. And what kind of mindset is he in as far as, you know, his condition as, you know, his life's completely changed. Everyone he knows is gone or dead. So what kind of emotional journey would he have to go through to still have any bit of hope, I guess? Yeah, that's just me, you know, spitballing ideas here. But something interesting I think you could definitely explore with the Obi-Wan series. And also, I believe they announced, too, with the Disney Plus series, they're coming weekly. It's not going to be like Netflix where you get the whole season at once, which I am glad they're doing weekly. I much prefer weekly. I mean, I enjoy binge watching as much as the next person, getting everything at once. But to really take a show and make it popular, you have to have people talking for longer periods of time. So, you know, Game of Thrones, I think part of the reason its appeal was that it did come out every week, and it wasn't just the entire season once. You didn't, you know, spend a weekend watching it and then talk about it for another week, and then it was done. You know, you had every week for 10 weeks or so, people were talking about it. That's, I think, a better build. It gives you, you know, more time, because I think there was that one phrase that just came up with, binge frustration? I forget what it's called, but basically it has to do with the fact that in this day and age, if you feel forced to watch a series as quickly as possible, Otherwise, it's going to get spoiled for you. And I got to be honest, I feel that way too, especially if, you know, you're someone like me who does a podcast, who'd like to talk about this stuff. And, you know, someone who's a big fan of this stuff too, you try to watch it before you step out on social media. Much like how on Game of Thrones, I had this rule where I would never go on social media on Sunday night until I watched Game of Thrones. Because I knew the moment I stepped on Twitter, there was going to be some spoilers. So I definitely, you know, feel like that pressure is there. Spreading it out over, you know, a couple of weeks, just one episode a week, I think relieves some of that pressure, but I also think helps with the ratings and viewership. So I think it's a good idea. I totally support that. Okay, so let's step over to movies. Saturdays, they had the movie panel, and basically we're talking episode 9, and we got a little featurette with episode 9, and this little thing that kind of reviewed the saga, the 6 films. You started off with the original trilogy, and then you went into the prequel trilogy, and then the current films with Force Awakens and The Last Jedi. And then with about 30 seconds left, you got to new footage of The Rise of Skywalker. But before that, they showed a poster, a little teaser poster. You got a little nice art of Rey and Kylo Ren fighting, and overhead is the eyes of the Emperor. And this kind of confirms that the Emperor is going to play some part in this film, whether he's actually coming back or whether he's going to be in the background as far as some contingency plans he had in place. We don't know, but it definitely confirms he's a part of it. It wasn't just a little bit of a misdirect that we saw during Star Wars Celebration in that first teaser. So the Emperor is playing a part here. No mistake about that. But obviously, the shot that everyone's talking about is the Rey red lightsaber shot. And I'll get to that in just a sec. But a couple of ones that I really liked. I liked the one with C-3PO people are talking about with the red eyes. Which is immediately when I saw the red eyes, I thought of, what is it, the protocol droid? It was in the Darth Vader comic. It's like a deadlier, meaner version of R2-D2 and C-3PO. I forget what they're called, but they're basically little bastards of droids. And I immediately thought of that, whether it was that character or if C-3PO was going to turn into something like that, I don't know. But I also thought too, wasn't there that one poster or something where C-3PO was holding a weapon? You know, maybe he's going into attack mode, perhaps. I don't know. But anyway, that was one shot. Another shot I really enjoyed was all the Star Destroyers. You know, you have these, you know, gosh, had to be 100 Star Destroyers or something like that. There was a lot, and it makes me think there is a big battle coming, especially since the shot before that was a bunch of X-Wings and Resistance fighters coming in, and there might be some big space battle coming. That would be cool. Then there's the shot of Rey and Kylo fighting in the middle of water on something. We're not sure what it is, but it was pretty much the scene that was teased in the poster. So we're all thinking it's kind of the big showdown between Kylo and Rey on that one. I'm a little disappointed, to be honest, because, you know, just stepping off real quick, is when Luke's lightsaber broke, or Anakin's lightsaber, whatever you want to call the original blue lightsaber, broke. It was my hope that Rey, much like how when, you know, Luke lost the lightsaber, he made a new one, that Rey would make a new lightsaber, and maybe one that would be a little cooler and a little more personal for her, in which case she's very good with a staff. So I would have loved to have seen a double-bladed blue lightsaber and her wield that like she does her bow. That would be really cool. Doesn't look like we're getting that. Looks like we're getting a version where, you know, she puts the lightsaber back together. Maybe a couple of minor modifications to it. But for the most part, it's pretty much the same lightsaber. And that's what she's fighting with in this scene with Kylo Ren. So, okay, fine, whatever. Now the shot, okay? It's Rey. She's got dark clothes on. She's got a double-bladed red lightsaber. And people went bananas for this shot. Now, most people are thinking it's some kind of like dream vision sequence, which is probably the best bet for that. I think somebody on my Twitter poll put up that maybe she's twin sister. You know, this is Star Wars. We do have Luke and Leia. Why not throw another set of twins in there? Could be possible, I guess. And then, of course, you know, there's theory that maybe she goes full dark side, which is something people might have speculated about because people are talking about how they don't want Kylo Ren to turn to the light side. He's gone through too much, and they don't want a redemptive story now. But then, you know, there's a theory that Rey might go dark side as well, and Kylo or Ben might have to return to the light to help save her, perhaps. I definitely don't think that's it. That's like my like 0.01% chance of things I think are going to happen. The other theory I'm thinking about, though, is that this is a clone of Rey. So, stay with me on this because, you know, people have talked about this, and I'm just going to reiterate a couple of things, is there have been theories about Rey ever since The Force Awakens and why is she so powerful in the Force. You know, Last Jedi said is because she had to balance out Kylo Ren. He's so strong on the dark side, so Rey had to balance out the light side. Understandable, and I will fully accept that answer. But people are always thinking she has to be related to somebody, she has to be a Skywalker, she has to be a Kenobi, whatever. And then there's the theory that maybe she's perhaps a clone of some kind. But not really a clone. The original concept idea that J.J. Abrams had for The Force Awakens started off with Luke's cut-off hand, the one he lost in Empire Strikes Back on Cloud City on Bespin, and that original lightsaber. Now we know Maz Kanata ended up with the lightsaber, which I still want to hear that story. I really do. But what about the hand that was attached to it? And originally, The Force Awakens started off with that hand in space. Now, a theory could be that someone found that hand, use the DNA from that hand to create a clone, a person, whatever, in the old Timothy Zahn trilogy, Heir to the Empire, the Thrawn trilogy, as they call it, although now we have a new Thrawn trilogy as far as books. But anyway, Luke fought a clone version of himself that was used from that hand. What if the Emperor took part of that hand and made not really Luke, but made a very strong force-powered person, multiple people, in fact, made multiple Reys, and one of them just happens to be Darkseid. It's pretty far out there, but we're talking clones. I mean, you know, it's Star Wars. Look at the prequel trilogy. Look at the Clone Wars, okay? Clones aren't that far off. I mean, the clone army themselves came from Jango Fett with modifications. Rey could have come from Luke or Anakin or whatever with some modifications. It's not that far off in the world of Star Wars, in my opinion. I mean, also, if you go back to Dark Empire, the original Dark Horse comic book, where the Emperor has a whole batch of clones of himself, and his spirit just transported from body to body once the other original body, you know, dried up and died or whatever. And that's another thing where you could bring in the Emperor for this as well. That's just a theory. So I would go with mainly, I think it's a vision or a dream sequence. My number two theory, I'm thinking some kind of clone perhaps, which I think would be really cool. It'd be really far out there. But J.J. Abrams, who's known for his secrecy in films and denying things that seem obvious, con. I don't know if they'd show that in the trailer, unless, again, it's so obvious that, you know, we don't believe it and they're trying to throw us off. But anyway, I want to hear your guys' theories. Fire back on the social media group and Gmail account. Let me know what you think. I put up a poll on Facebook and on Twitter, and most people think it seems to be a vision. You know, clone is probably the second theory, but vision or dream sequence is the number one theory on that. And more than likely, that's the most possible answer, but I think it'd be cool to be some kind of clone, too. But all right, guys, that is it for me today. I got to go pick my daughter up from school, so I will hopefully pick her up, do some editing on this, and get it posted up sometime Tuesday evening. So what'd you guys think of D23? Let me hear what your thoughts are on the Marvel news. Let me hear your thoughts on any of the Star Wars news, what you're excited about, what you're not excited about, what you wanted to hear, and maybe they didn't announce. Let me hear from you guys. Facebook group, Twitter account, dayscreendiscussions@gmail.com. And like I said, that is it for me today. Friday, as I said, Dark Crystal, Age of Resistance comes out on Netflix, and Carnival Row are two things that I'm going to check out hopefully this weekend and plan on talking about on next week's shows. Friday, probably going to be my next episode. Like I said, Jaime's supposed to come by. We're going to talk Young Justice Outsiders. If he doesn't show up, I'm still going to talk about the season finale and then some, so stay tuned for that. But that's it, guys. Go out, enjoy the day, live your best life, and until next time, may the Force be with us all.